Okay, let me start by thanking Paul very much for taking the initiative to nominate me for this medal. I'm a chancer, I just pretended to know a few things, but the letters of recommendation were superlative and convinced the assessors that they should give me a gong. So really, I won't name all the people who wrote letters of recommendation, but I'm really grateful to them all. I'll name Paul in particular, but I'm grateful to them all, so thank them all for that. So let me give the talk much along the lines that I presented in Prague, a little longer because I was cut short there, but it's about balanced flow on this spinning globe. The outline doesn't need to be read. But I want to start at the beginning. You could say, it's nice to make provocative statements, and I could say, you know, Galileo invented science. But I'd have to follow that by discuss. But it's something to think about. He certainly innovated in many major ways, and his list of accomplishments is tremendous. But I'm particularly interested in stressing the fact that he's credited with inventing the thermometer. And his student, his ace PhD, Evangelista Torricelli, devised the barometer. So that from that time on, we were actually measuring things in the atmosphere. Up till then, meteorology was qualitative, it was descriptive, but now we could start to measure. It didn't take them long to notice there was a connection of some sort between the height of the mercury and the state of the weather. If it was so simple, of course, we'd all be out of a job. It's not a perfect correlation, but there is obviously a strong relationship between the pressure patterns and the meteorological conditions. So this was the beginning of quantitative meteorology. Galileo did many things. The spoil sports say that this never happened. I mean, what nonsense. He was in Pisa. He wanted to drop stuff. Where would you go? I mean, it stands to reason. And his biographer, Viviani, makes it quite clear, to the dismay of the philosophers, different weights fell at the same speed. It's very clear there. So I think he did it. A recent biography backs up the idea of this too and calls these people iconoclasts, people who say he never did this experiment. I just call them spoil sports. So it's a fairly heavy biography, but very interesting read. Another thing Galileo realized and expressed very clearly, of course, was the mathematical nature of the universe. The universe is written in the language of mathematics, and he really socks it to you. I mean, people are afraid to say this stuff these days. You know, without it, it's impossible to understand a single word. I mean, that is a very definite statement. It's great. I wish people would speak more like that today. Now, mathematics, we've got to do some, we all love it, but this is as hard as it gets, really. A plus B plus C is equal to zero. If one of them is small, if A is small, then we can write B plus C is approximately zero, and we have a simpler equation. And we use these ideas to simplify the equations of the atmosphere, and we can go quite a long way with this simple idea. Of course, it might be B that's smaller, it might be C, but it's the same idea. We take a complicated equation, we throw away small bits, and we may be lucky and be left with something manageable. So I'll move on then to the central theme of the talk, which is the balance in the atmosphere. And the list is very long, but I'll consider only the main aspects of balance. Now, one of the remarkable things about the atmosphere is that the phenomena that we observe are very long-lived. If you get a balloon, blow up a balloon, and then stick a pin in it, it's just, the pressure difference is gone almost instantaneously. So you might well ask, you know, why doesn't a storm just go bang, fill up, and be gone? It doesn't, it lasts not hours, but days and maybe weeks. So this persistence is an interesting quality, and we need to know what's the reason for it. Of course, it's the rotation of the Earth. The dynamical consequences of the fact that the Earth spins around pretty rapidly have profound influence on the motion systems. Now, here's a typical weather map. There's nothing special about this. It shows what I'd call isobars. They're not quite isobars. And it shows wind arrows. And up at the top, you see a jet stream. and towards the bottom in the middle you see a cutoff low. And I look at the map then 24 hours later, and without worrying too much about details, you see it's rather similar. Here we start 24 hours later. The low is still there. It hasn't filled up. It hasn't gone away. And the jet stream is there. The troughs and ridges have moved a little. But it's a very slowly evolving system, really. And we want to look at this. Now, this is Jules Charney, who is one of the most outstanding meteorologists of the 20th century. He was also Ray Bates' PhD doctoral advisor. And Charney put it in a nice way. He said, if you chuck a rock into a stationary ocean, it will generate waves which will radiate away, and very quickly the ocean will be smooth again. But if you're on a rotating planet, if a stone is thrown into an infinite rotating ocean, then some of the motion will be converted into rotation and will persist, so that after a very long time, you'll still have a local disturbance arising from the initial disturbance. And this is very different and purely due to the influence of rotation. It's not peculiar to the Earth. This is Jupiter, and one of the features you see here is this great red spot. And this has been there for hundreds of years, raging around. There are many interesting theories as to what's causing that. I won't go into any of them. But the great red spot, the point is, it's a persistent phenomenon. It's lasted, as I say, at least since the time of Galileo, maybe longer. And if we look at Saturn, the next gas giant, there's a vortex spinning around the North Pole of Saturn. This is a much more recent discovery. But again, it's a persistent phenomenon. It doesn't seem to be going anywhere very quickly. So this persistence in rotating planets is something we find on a widespread scale. There's also an interesting hexagonal pattern there, which is probably what we call in the Earth's atmosphere a Rossby wave. But I don't know too much about that. Now I'll talk briefly about the 20th century reanalysis. Scientists have gone back and assembled all the data they could find for the entire 20th century to try to reconstruct the state of the atmosphere on a day-by-day basis. And they've come up with this. But really, for the first half of the century, there was little more than pressure observations at the surface. And yet the challenge was to reconstruct the three-dimensional structure of the atmosphere. And this is a picture from a page from a website. And the box that's surrounded there in red, assimilating only surface observations of pressure. That's the key phrase. And yet, they were able to reconstruct the entire three-dimensional structure of the atmosphere very well. The picture here, the two panels, are for two different reanalysis. The top one is for the analysis I've been speaking of, which uses only surface pressure observations. On the bottom, it's a picture of the zonal wind, that's the east-west component of the wind, and it's plotted from pole to pole and from the surface of the Earth up to the tropopause, about 12 kilometers. And in each hemisphere, you see the jet stream, so the strongest wind is here, the strong vertical wind shear in one hemisphere and in the other hemisphere, jet stream in each, and then in the tropical latitudes, you have easterly winds, winds from the east. And that's all somehow magically reproduced. And if we look at the ERA analysis, this picture was made using a huge wealth of satellite data and radio zone data, all the three-dimensional observations throughout the atmosphere. But it's remarkable how similar the two pictures are. So you might ask, I think there was a television program recently, how do they do that? And it's mystifying. How do they do that? And of course, the reason is that the different atmospheric fields are strongly coupled with each other. So information about surface pressure actually gives us indirectly information about the other fields. And that's the idea of balance. The atmosphere is in a state of balance, and the different dynamical fields are strongly connected or coupled to each other. So we can reconnect. We can deduce one from the other. There's another reanalysis underway in the European Center, but I haven't seen the outputs from that, so we wait to see how that'll work out. So here is a list of some of the main types of balance in the atmosphere. And I certainly won't have time to talk about them all, but I'll get through two or three of them: hydrostatic, geostrophic, and so on. Okay, one interesting thing about the atmosphere is it's a remarkably thin layer upon the Earth. We're lucky to be here, really, to have this very delicate skin of gas just resting on the planet. It's remarkable. 80% of the atmosphere, about 80%, is below 12 kilometers or so. Now, the Earth's radius is over 6,000 kilometers, so you can see it's really, really thin. As I say, it's amazing how much life and what wealth is sustained by this thin layer. But you might well ask, as a child might ask, why isn't it thinner still? Why doesn't the air just fall down? And we have to think about that for a minute. What's keeping it up? Gravity should be dragging it down, but of course, the pressure increases as we go downwards. So if you think of a parcel of air, this is a favorite conceptual thing. We're always talking about parcels of air. So you think of a parcel of air, it's being weighed down, or it's been pushed down by the air above, it's been pushed up by the air below, and there's a bigger upward push than a downward push. So it should go upwards, but of course gravity is then counteracting that. So we get a balance between the two. We can write out, if we like mathematics, we can write out an equation for the vertical motion here. I won't go into details. We'll just remember our ABC and throw away all the yellow stuff and keep the green stuff, because it turns out the two of the terms are dominant. The two terms here are on the left, the vertical pressure gradient, the change in pressure with height, and on the right, you see G there, which is the acceleration due to gravity. And we have a very close balance between these. You might actually say the atmosphere is addicted to hydrostatic balance. And if you dare to disturb it, it gets very agitated. It gets back into balance really quickly. So we can, for a lot of the time, we can assume this as a perfect balance. That's hydrostatic balance. And it relates very much to the vertical structure of the atmosphere and allows us to connect different levels together. If we have information, as we had in the reanalysis, we have the surface pressure, we can now start to think, what are the implications for the conditions higher up? But the next kind of balance is geostrophic balance. Isn't that a nice word? And it's due to Sir Napier Shaw, who was a director of the Met Office in Britain around about the time of the First World War. And he was a classical scholar and took the two Greek roots for Earth and turning and called it geostrophic. It's just horrible to think what people would do today. I bet you it would be called some dreadful acronym, or Google or Yahoo or some silly word would be chosen for this. But we have this beautiful classical word, geostrophic, and we should cherish it because it's a nice thing and very descriptive of what's going on. It suggests the turning of the Earth as the key factor. And of course, that's true. So again, we go back to a weather map and just look again now. We start to look at the winds and notice they're not blowing across the isobars, they're blowing more or less along the isobars. Of course, that implies that the low is not just going to fill up in a hurry, it's going to spin, it's going to rotate around and persist. And that flow is in or close to a geostrophic balance. Now, this was noticed sometime in the middle of the 19th century by Christophorus Buys-Ballot. I suppose if I did one thing in Holland, I at least learned how to pronounce his name. So Buys-Ballot, we usually call him Buys-Ballot. That's good enough, I guess. So his law is an empirical law. He was a polymath, as you see. But he noticed the patterns where the winds and the pressure seem to be related. And the way he formulated it was as a simple rule of thumb. In the northern hemisphere, if you stand with your back to the wind, then the low pressure is on your left. And imagine how useful that could be to somebody like a mariner, you know, to have a lot of information encapsulated in a very simple, memorable rule. In fact, it has been expressed in other ways. One of them I like to call the GPS version, and that says if you stand with your back to the wind and the low pressure's on your left, then you must be in the northern hemisphere. So I'd like to claim credit for that, but I think the guilty party is probably Raymond Hyde, who's currently at Imperial College in London. So that was a rule of thumb, but it doesn't get you very far. We need something more quantitative. And the quantitative parallel or equivalent of that was formulated by William Ferrell, an American meteorologist. He was working largely on his own and didn't have too many, didn't find it easy to get his work recognized. But he published a paper, an essay on the winds and the currents of the oceans. And that was published in a very curious place. It was published in the Nashville Journal of Medicine and Surgery. Goodness knows why. I've never really found out why, but I think he couldn't get it published in the normal meteorological journals, and his friends, he must have had some friends who were doctors or whatever, and they published it in that. Or who knows, maybe that had a higher H factor. I really don't know. But at all events, I won't read this. They're just snippets from the paper. And the important message really is that he noticed, of course, that the centrifugal effect of air which is spinning was going to be important dynamically. And in particular, if the air was moving relative to the Earth, then this would change. So he talked in the last line about a disturbing force which materially influences the motion. In fact, he did much more. He wrote down the actual dynamical equations, term by term, explicitly, and I think he was perhaps the first to do so, to write a reasonably complete set of dynamical equations for the atmosphere. So the Americans, where we talk about Bayes-Ballot's law, they talk about Ferrell's law with some justification. And this is a typical diagram from an elementary book on meteorology, and you see the wind blowing along the isobar here. The low pressure's on the left, so there's a pressure gradient force to the left. The Coriolis force in the northern hemisphere always acts to the right, and those two more or less balance. And then if you want to get a bit more fancy, you take into account the curvature of the isobars, and you get the centrifugal effect, and those three components together give you what's called gradient balance. And for a high pressure, it's more or less the same thing, only backwards. So let's look at the horizontal equations of motion. I won't describe them term by term. If you haven't seen them, there's not much going to come out of this, but the end result should be graspable. We're going to talk about steady motion. You saw that the weather map one day looks fairly like the weather map the next. So we can assume, at least as a starting point, let's say the wind is not changing with time. But still, the other terms are there. So the other terms will have to balance. So those three green terms, which I'll call the centrifugal force, Coriolis force, and pressure gradient force, will have to add up to zero. That's our ABC, if you like. That's all we're doing, just chugging stuff away, which is small. So this balance between those three components is known as gradient balance. But it's too hard for us. The three terms bad, two terms good, as Orwell did not say. So supposing the centrifugal force is small, then we can chuck this term away, and then we have the other two terms balancing. And that's called geostrophic balance. On the other hand, if the Coriolis force is small, the Coriolis term is small, we're going to get a balance between centrifugal force and pressure gradient force. And that's known as cyclostrophic balance. And then the third possibility, supposing the pressure is equal everywhere, then the gradient of pressure will vanish. So the third term will vanish, and we're going to get a balance between the remaining two, which is called inertial balance. That's very interesting, but I don't have time to say much about it. I'm just introducing a bit of notation here, using F for what's called the Coriolis parameter. Omega is the angular velocity of the Earth spinning around, and phi is the latitude. But the details don't matter too much. This is geostrophic balance, and it just means the effect of rotation is balancing the effect of pressure changes. Okay? So there's a remarkable property of this equation is that we can actually solve it for the wind. We can manipulate the terms and get an expression for the wind in terms of the pressure. So here's the pressure here. If I know the pressure field, I can calculate the right-hand side, and so I can get the left-hand side, which is a wind. And this is really astounding. We're so used to it in meteorology, we get a bit blasé. But it's very surprising that knowing the pressure, you know about the wind. It's quite unusual. In a non-rotating system, that's very far from the truth. So we can determine the wind. You give me the pressure, I'll give you the wind. It's cool, isn't it? So now, what are the implications of this? Well, let's go back to the equations and do what people call scale analysis. What we do now is we introduce typical sizes for the different terms. So we say, let's suppose the storm is 1,000 miles wide and the pressure difference is 40 millibars and things like that, just hand-waving order of magnitudes. We plug these into the terms and we can get an estimate of the sizes. And if we say the change is due to the pressure gradient, then we can figure out how fast things are going to change. And the typical time scale comes to about 3 hours. And that would imply that if we saw a large storm or a hurricane, then in 3 hours or 6 hours, it'll be gone. So we know that's not true. So now let's look at the rotating Earth. Now the time scale is going to be governed by terms like this, because if there's geostrophic balance, the other two terms, you can think of them as gone, they've cancelled. So we look at the size of this, it's called an advective time scale. We plug in typical sizes for the different variables, and we get an order of magnitude increase. Now, if you haven't followed the details, it's not a problem. The main message is that the rotation increases the time scale by an order of magnitude, which is really a profound influence on the motion. I'm going to skip this because if I start here, I'm going to be on my hobby horse. This is wrong, wrong, wrong. Oh, I'm so tempted to spend 10 minutes slating the guy who wrote this. Nah, skip it. It's just that I'll just say that a lot of the descriptions in elementary books leave certain questions unanswered and are misleading. But no, it's just a hobby horse. Let's move on. One aspect of geostrophic motion is we have an expression for it. By doing a little bit of fiddling, we can write it as what's called a curl. And those of you who've done your vector analysis know that the gradient of a curl, or divergence of a curl, always vanishes. Okay, so the implication is the divergence of the geostrophic wind is zero. In physical sense, you think it's swirling around, it's not going in and out, it's just going round and round. So that's another simplification. Okay, but what I'm going to do now is look at some atmospheric systems. What's the time story? Good, okay. I'm going to look at some atmospheric systems, and I'm going to move from the largest scales to the smallest scales and see what the balance can tell us about those. So this guy on Time magazine is not too often a weatherman gets his mugshot on Time magazine, but this is Carl Gustav Rossby, an outstanding Swedish-American meteorologist. And the number that I'm going to introduce is called the Rossby number after him. And on the right, I define a ratio here between different terms. We can define the Rossby number in a number of ways, but we can think of it as the relative size of the centrifugal force and the Coriolis force for a weather system. Another way to write it is in below that, we can think of it as the magnitude of the spin of the flow, so the weather system's spin, divided by the Earth's spin. Okay? And for most weather systems, this Rossby number is quite small, and it allows us to simplify things. So let's look at a map of the Rossby number, a typical map. So this is what a 500 millibar chart. In other words, it's the chart of the pressure, roughly speaking, halfway up through the troposphere, in the middle of the troposphere, about 5 kilometers. And these are the pressure lines. Now, from this information, we can calculate the Rossby number point by point. So we can draw a map of the Rossby number. It's quite unusual. This is about the only one I've seen, but here we are. And the only thing to worry about here is that if we look at the values, trying to point, there's 0.1. So the Rossby number is 1 over 10. 1 over 10, go over here, it's 1 over 10. There are a few hot spots, that's in the middle of the storm, where it gets bigger. But generally speaking, the Rossby number for the mid-tropospheric flow is quite small. So that is consistent with looking at the broad scales. And I'm going to look at a range of weather systems and see what the Rossby number is like and what is the consequential balance. So we start with the largest systems. This is an extratropical depression. It's got a beautiful spiral structure, but that's not important here. You can just about see Iceland. Here, just give you some geographical location. And if you take typical parameter values, you find the Rossby number is about 1 over 10 for this system. So that should mean that geostrophic balance should hold quite well. And indeed it does. I'm not going into the calculations, but this system is quite close to being in geostrophic balance. So if we know the pressure pattern, we know the wind. If you want to do a bit better, add in the centrifugal force and you'll get an even more accurate estimate. Okay, and this is the sort of balance we see in weather charts. That's another weather chart, not chosen for any particular reason, just whatever one was to hand. And we see a low pressure system here, and the wind arrows blowing very well behaved around it, more or less parallel to the isobars. Okay, we'll move down a scale here and look at a hurricane or a tropical storm. Now there's a double whammy here because the spatial scale has gone down and the velocity scale has gone up. So now, instead of being small, the Rossby number is starting to be large. It might be 10 or it might be 100. It's certainly not small, so geostrophic balance isn't going to get us very far. But if we allow for the centrifugal effect of the air swirling around in a tight circle, then the gradient balance does okay. But could you say, hang on, why don't we just forget about the Coriolis force then and just take cyclostrophic balance? Well, it's not quite that simple, because the distribution of these tropical cyclones is amazing. This is a map showing the occurrence of hurricanes, typhoons, and cyclones, all the same thing, over a long period. Okay, with different strengths and so on, but the details are not so important. What's amazing is that there's a big gap right along the equator. So what did they say in My Fair Lady? Near the equator, hurricanes hardly happen. In fact, I don't think, I've never known a hurricane to cross the equator. If anyone knows of one, let me know, but I've never heard of this. So there's a band there where you just don't find these storms. So the rotation of the Earth must be having an influence of them. And of course, it's in the formative stage that the rotation of the Earth is important. Once they get going, they spin up and they're swirling around, then the rotation isn't so important anymore. The rotation of the Earth, the rotation of the storm, of course, is. But I think this distribution is very strong evidence that in the initial stages, something really important is happening thanks to the Earth's rotation. So Napier-Shaw, always with the bon mot, he put it this way: I always find my pen sticks to the paper and refuses to move when I try to draw an isobar across the equator. It's a nice way to put it. If you try to do the classical extratropical analysis at the equator, the pencil just won't move. That's the way he puts it. It's nice. So we'll move down another notch now. So we've a smaller, faster system. The strongest winds we observe are in tornadoes. So again, the spatial scale has gone down, the velocity scale has gone up. So the Rossby number now might be anything up to 10 to the power of 4. So for sure it's not geostrophic. It's close to cyclostrophic balance with the centrifugal, the effect of the curvature and the effect of pressure gradient balancing closely. Generally speaking, at the same time, these spin in what I might call the correct direction. They spin as if the Earth's rotation had been influential. So much so that some crowd of Did I say chancers? I don't know. Somebody published a paper some years ago and noticed there seemed to be a correlation between the intensity of traffic on the motorways and the occurrence of tornadoes in the Midwest. So you know what correlations are all about. You know, it's like saying the sales of ice cream have been going up for the last 20 years, so global warming must be caused by ice cream. I mean, and they did actually propose that in America they should drive on the other side of the road. But it's just a cod, really. But actually, not all tornadoes spin in the correct direction in accordance with what you'd expect if the Earth's rotation were dominant. In fact, only 98 or 99% do. But just to find out from a great source of knowledge, I went to Wikipedia and put in anticyclonic tornado. And to my considerable surprise, found a long list. I haven't time to talk about them, but there's a long list, a lot of information about tornadoes which actually spin in the opposite direction. So that's, you know, that means, of course, that then we can't blame the rotation of the Earth. So let's go down to the domestic scale now, and of course the bathtub, we all think of the bathtub. And if you look closely at that photograph, it's kind of going the wrong way again. It's spinning around clockwise. If it was in geostrophic balance, it would have to go the other way. Of course, I know what you're going to say. You're going to say, I got that photograph and I put it in Photoshop and I flipped it over. Yeah. Well, anyhow, of course, at this scale, the rotation of the Earth is completely irrelevant. The only person I've heard arguing otherwise is Homer Simpson. There is quite a good episode of The Simpsons where they go to Australia and, you know, do a deep scientific study of this. But in reality, of course, the bath water goes down one way or the other depending on the initial conditions. If it happens to be spinning cyclonically, when you pull the plug, it'll probably continue to do so. So don't worry. So there are a review of many types of balance. I want to look now at the Foucault pendulum because I've been talking about rotation. And you might say, how do we know the Earth is rotating? And of course, we've known from astronomical considerations for a good while. Probably there were heated arguments about that. But nevertheless, it's a relatively uncontroversial issue these days that the Earth is rotating. But the first demonstration in terms of a terrestrial experiment was only in 1851. And it was done by Léon Foucault, and he did a wonderful, really delightful demonstration of this in the Pantheon in Paris. I have a little note there because it's not entirely true what I'm saying. Laplace and Gauss had both looked at falling objects, and the theory indicates that if you're at the equator and you drop an object, it will actually fall slightly to the east of where you drop it. But it's a very small effect. If you drop it from 100 meters, it'll fall about 1 centimeter to the east. But of course, there are so many perturbations and noises going on, you can only pick this up statistically. Sometimes it might go west, it might be blown, or you might not drop it perfectly, and so on. So it's only a statistical effect, and they weren't able to find it at the time. So the first really convincing demonstration was Foucault. And the idea is very simple, at least for a pendulum at the North Pole. Because imagine the pendulum is swinging in this plane that I indicate with my hand, and it'll keep on swinging in that plane. Why should it go anywhere else? But in the meantime, the Earth will rotate underneath it, and we standing on the Earth will be rotating, and we will see the pendulum appear to rotate in the opposite direction. So it's a very simple demonstration. Now, if you go to Paris, where the experiment was actually done, things are a lot more complicated because now the point of suspension is being accelerated around with the Earth. But nevertheless, it has been mathematically examined and the effect is similar. The rotation rate is not the same. It doesn't go around a full rotation in one day, but it goes around at a known and understood rate. So that's a nice photograph of the Pantheon, and you can see the bob of the pendulum there. And you can see a remarkable number of totally disinterested people. I don't know. at least one guy at least is interested enough to take a photograph. So, but it's worth going there, but I believe at the moment it has been dismantled and won't be back for a year or two, so don't go rushing off after the talk. But that's it. And this caused a kind of mania around the world. And the experiment, everyone wanted to repeat this. Some would have said, I don't believe that, let's try it. And some would have said, I believe it, let's try it. So they tried it in many places. In particular in Dublin, this experiment was repeated. And that's a map, one of the old maps you can get on the Ordnance Survey. Here is Grand Canal Basin, or Hanover Basin. That bit is now filled in. There are the gasometers. I think one of them is gone. That here is now Grand Canal Dock Station on the Dart. So this would have been the Dublin and Kingstown Railway. It's now the Dart Line. And in here is a large shed. You can see railway works. And they actually built railway locomotives in there. And these things make a lot of smoke and steam, so they would have had a high roof. And that was the key, because the high roof enabled these two guys, Galbraith and Houghton, two reverends from Trinity, to repeat the experiment. I think it was 36 meters or something, I can't remember the details. But they repeated the experiment within about 2 months of Foucault. Not only that, they did a pretty comprehensive mathematical analysis and published it in the Philosophical Magazine, really explaining the motion of the plane and demonstrating the effect of the Earth's rotation. Another analysis was done by Matthew O'Brien, and I'll come back to him in a few minutes, if I have time. You do warn me.
We have 5 minutes.
Okay. Maybe. I want to make it harder. It's too easy. Okay, Coriolis effect. I've talked a little about Coriolis. Coriolis himself didn't actually study geophysics. He was looking at rotating machinery, but he did look at the dynamical effects of rotation. And that's what's important. Now, Newtonian mechanics assumes that we have an absolute unaccelerated frame of reference, and Newton's laws are what we call covariant in all inertial frames. In other words, they keep their mathematical form. They're not covariant in an accelerating frame. If we go to an accelerating frame, like standing on the Earth, because it's spinning around, then the equations change. We can write Newton's equations like this. The rate of change of momentum is equal to the applied force. Very nice. That's valid in all inertial frames. But if we break it into components, like we normally would in Cartesian components, they're no longer invariant. You can see this easily, because that's an expression for Newton's laws in a Cartesian coordinate. But if you now go to a polar coordinate, which we like to do on occasions, you get extra bits coming in here. And you can't just go like I do and chuck away the green bit, because it's important. It's dynamically important. So the equations, the component equations, are not covariant. And we'd like to try and fix that. So for a point in fixed to the Earth, we'll denote that by x prime. And if we then stand outside on the sun or outside the Earth itself and look at it, it's spinning around, we see it moving. And the motion is given by this expression, which is the vector product of the rotation, the angular rotation of the Earth and the position. Okay, this is the source of all the confusion, because vector products are confusing. If you ask somebody a question about a vector product, he won't be able to keep his hands in his pocket. Right hand's going this way. They start waffling and telling you confusing things, and it just gets worse. So this is really, I think, the essence of the confusion, is that vector products are inherently, can be counterintuitive. We need to go slowly. Okay? So if a particle is moving on the Earth, there are two things happening. It has its motion relative to the Earth's surface, and then it has the motion due to the spin of the Earth. So you get two bits. So the absolute velocity is the relative velocity plus the velocity of the frame. Okay, now we come to my recent hero, Matthew O'Brien. I only discovered about him quite recently. He was born in Ennis, but went away to study in Cambridge, and he was, I would say, an inventor of vector calculus, because several different people were coming from different angles, so I don't want to say the inventor. Okay? And he formulated this equation for the change in a vector in an absolute frame is equal to the change in the rotating frame plus this term due to the rotation. And that is quite a central equation in geophysics. It comes up again and again. And it doesn't have a name, so I thought, why not call it O'Brien's equation? Now, it was known, the content of this was known earlier, but the expression in terms of a vector equation was never done before O'Brien. And it's used again and again. So I think I wrote a paper that's going to come out soon in the Bulletin of the Irish Mathematical Society about O'Brien and his equation. So who knows, it might catch on. You never know. Okay, so let's use O'Brien's equations for the position. And then we get this expression, but we had this already. The velocity has two bits. But now let's get smart and use O'Brien's equation for the velocity. And then if we do that, we get it's a bit messy, isn't it? But there's extra bits coming in, and they're the bits we want. This is the key. So we find that the acceleration in the absolute frame is the acceleration in the relative to the Earth plus extra bits. And the extra bits are the Coriolis force, or Coriolis acceleration, the centrifugal acceleration, and another bit with a dot on top. Forget it. Okay, so we can now write Newton's equations. This is the acceleration that we always know and love. That's the way we always write Newton's equation. And then we have our force, and then these extra bits we've put on the right-hand side, and now they look like forces. So it's a real cheat. They're not forces, they're inertial accelerations scaled by the mass. But the point is that the equations are right. The two additional force terms now appear as forces. Okay, there's an even craftier way to do this. You can define a new operator. Instead of having the usual change with respect to time, you can define this big D and then go through the motions, and you can actually write the equations in this form, which is covariant. But as you know, why would we do that? Because it was done in a smarter way by Lagrange, who considered energy. He said, look, take the energy, the potential and the kinetic energy, take the difference of them. Let's call it, he says, what will I call it? Oh, I know, the Lagrangian, after me. So that's what it's called now, anyway. And lo and behold, Lagrange's equations are actually covariant. I'm sorry for those of you who have never seen this before. It's total obscurity. But the point is that these equations are valid in all frames of reference. So they have this property that I call covariance. Now, covariance is a big deal in relativity, in fact. And Einstein pointed out, of course, the basic fundamental laws cannot depend on the frame. You know, what does it matter if you're standing on the Earth or on the Moon or Mars or wherever? The basic physical equations, physical laws, should be the same. So he introduced this principle of relativity. And I asked myself, you know, can we use this principle to actually deduce the form of the Coriolis terms and so on? And I was working away on that a few months ago, and then out comes a paper with all the answers done. Great, I don't have to do it anymore. So the answer is yes, we can do it, but it's not as easy as ABC. So if you think it was bad, it's about to get worse. There's a nice paper has appeared in the Quarterly Journal of the Royal Meteorological Society. It's just come out a few months ago by a group in Montreal in Canada, Martin Charron et al. And they have written the equations of the atmosphere in a full tensorial form that is covariant. And of course, I'm not going to go into exact details of what all these terms are, but it looks like you think, my goodness, I've picked up the wrong journal. I'm reading about relativity here, not about meteorology, what's happening. But they've done it, and it's very nice. And the idea, of course, is you go back to your geometry and you consider the concept of distance between points. You can write that down in terms of this little metric, and then you can move from one frame to the other, switch a Rooney, you get a different form, and then you can write a metric tensor, and then you remember your equation for the geodesics, which you all know by heart, and you plug it in, but the end result is cool. The end result after all this is you have your equations with the Coriolis terms and the centrifugal terms here. So, I mean, the upshot of all this, of course, is that this concept, the thinking that's used in relativity applies directly to the atmospheric equations. Now, why would we do all this? You know, am I just making things harder? Well, the equations themselves are now in a fundamental invariant form. They preserve their form in all coordinate systems. So if we switch from one to the other, whether we're spinning with the Earth or standing in space, same. The transformations are handled in a very systematic way. Approximations can be done very rigorously, so you know what you're doing. And conservation of things like angular momentum and energy and so on can be conserved. So the basic idea is you have a systematic way of handling the equations. And the Coriolis effect just falls out basically as a geometric consequence. So it's cool. I'm definitely going to skip this bit. But I want to come back to my old friend Galileo, because he's sucking it to us again. He says, without this understanding, one is wandering around in a dark labyrinth. So I hope at least I've lit a little, what do you call the nightlight, or a candle, to have some idea of what's going on. So I'm going to finish with Richardson's forecast, because what's this balance? I mean, what does it matter? Well, it really mattered. The very first major attempt to predict the weather by using the physical laws was done by Richardson, Lewis Fry Richardson, and it was a disastrous failure. And we want to know why. So he actually did the calculations by hand. It took him something like 2 years. And he calculated that the pressure in at a point near Munich would change in 6 hours by 145 millibars. Now that's never, that just doesn't happen. It's totally unrealistic. It's two orders of magnitude larger than what we see. So it's crazy. And yet, I'm saying Richardson's method was scientifically sound. He had the right equations, his calculations were correct. And yet it gets a totally daft answer. What's going on? Well, here's a little limerick. Young Richardson wanted to know how quickly the pressure would grow. But what a surprise, because the 6-hourly rise was in pascals. 145. Oh. Okay, that's a graph of the pressure. This is schematic, of course. We're just thinking here what's going on. Imagine the pressure is changing over a period of 1 day. And we're looking for the slope of the line, which gives the change in pressure. But in the real world, things tend to be a bit noisier. And the graph is like this. This is more like what you'd see on a barograph, little wiggles and waggles. So what we want to calculate is the slope of the blue line, which gives you the mean change in pressure. But what we actually get, and what Richardson got, was the instantaneous change in pressure, indicated by the red line. So it's the slope of the purple curve. And for a noisy system, the instantaneous rate of change, which was 145 hectopascals in 6 hours, that gives you no guidance to the long-term behavior of the system. So that was really his downfall. His data was corrupted by gravity wave noise, and he got a daft answer. Okay? Now, I repeated his forecast, not taking 2 years to do it, taking a second or so on a computer. And originally, I was able to reproduce his changes in pressure of 145 hectopascals, sure enough. So that at least made me feel confident that the program was probably okay, because it got the same answer that he got. But then, when I imposed a process called initialization on the data, which basically removes this noise from the initial data, then the forecast changed to something less than 1 hectopascal in 6 hours, which of course is very realistic. In fact, the barometer was pretty steady on that occasion. So it just goes to show that balanced initial data is essential, because that's another talk for another day, to talk about how that is done. But it comes down to a direct application of the ideas of balance that I've been talking about for the last half hour. Do I have 3 minutes, or should I stop? Okay, I'll just talk very briefly then about the ENIAC forecast, because in order to, when computers were devised in about 1950, they wanted to do weather forecasts on the computer, but they knew if they do the same thing Richardson did, they would get the same crazy results. So that's no good. So what they did was they used a drastically simplified set of equations which have no noise in them. They filter out all the noise and implicitly build in the balance into the equations. So that was a good thing to do. The ENIAC is described here. It was an enormous machine, would fill a room this size. Valves blowing, mean time between failure was about an hour. So it was a difficult machine to use. And this is the equation they used. It simply said that the spin of the atmosphere keeps its initial value as you move along with the flow. That's called barotropic vorticity equation. And the point of that is it implicitly has the balance which we find in the atmosphere, so you don't have the problems with the noise. And there are some maps that were produced from the very first forecast. I haven't time to describe them, but this is an analysis and this is a forecast. Ideally, these two panels should be identical. They're not identical, but I think what's reasonable to say is they both look like weather maps. So the forecast, if not accurate, is at least realistic. Okay, now I repeated this on a laptop. I think I want to skip quickly. Yeah, okay. You can now, I mean, the ENIAC, as I say, filled the room, but now your mobile phone has much more power than the ENIAC had, and certainly a laptop computer is orders of magnitude faster. So you can do this stuff very easily now. And this is a repeat of the forecast. And without going into details, you find that the results are pretty much the same. The angular look on these is simply because I avoided putting in smoothing into the graphics. That was deliberately to avoid introducing some artifice. Okay, but as I say, ENIAC was one of the first machines, but a mobile phone now has more power than the ENIAC had, so I thought, well, surely we can run this ENIAC forecast on a mobile phone. And I did that, and we had to give it a name, and I thought, ENIAC, why not PhoniAC? when having thought of PhoniAC, then we did some reverse engineering to work out what the heck does PhoniAC stand for. So we put it there, portable hand operated. This was done, actually, Owen, my son Owen is somewhere in the audience, but I can't see him. But Owen helped me to program this for the mobile phone. And we got a little paper published in Weather Magazine, which was fun. And then somebody in the American Math Society took an interest 5 years later, goodness knows why, and put it on the cover, way out of date by then, and the phone even looks like an antique at this stage. But I call that the other AMS, because the AMS to most of us is the American Met Society. This is the American Maths Society. You know, a kind of second-rate AMS, but what can you do? Sorry, guys. So at that stage, thank you.